the war and the truth. And some of the things that are going to be said at the end are going to be a little bit harsh, I think, because I think it's important that they be said, because I think we really live at a very dangerous time for the true church with the deception that's coming in. And I'll show you some examples of that today. I don't know how long this will take. I'm actually going to play some clips of, I got the idea, Natalie Cole died the other day, and one of her great videos was the video she did with her father. So I thought, well, we haven't seen Jacob for a while, so I'll do sort of a little video with him today and play some things of a message that he gave many, many years ago, in 2001, actually, in Hawaii. And actually, I think Steve Mitchell was a pastor at the church that he gave it at when it happened. And people didn't like what Jacob said then. But what Jacob said then is as relevant today as it has ever been, because there is a war on the truth going on. But we'll talk today a little bit. We're going to divide this into two parts. We're going to talk a little bit about some of the things going on in the news. And then it's conference season, so it's I don't know what to call it, apostasy palooza out there this past week. And we're getting closer to the time. But as we get closer, we're going to have to be more and more careful the things that we listen to. So let's just look at a few of the news events, and then we'll get into some scripture, and then we will get into a little bit of a team teaching with Jacob and I, mainly Jacob. Some interesting things. I have not heard about this. Did you hear about this gas leak in California? It's been going on for quite a bit of time. It's right up near where the 118 freeway, it goes from the 405, it goes west, it goes past through Simi Valley, and then it turns down there at Moore Park, and it goes down to around Thousand Oaks. And then the 405 goes up just a little bit north of the 118 and joins up with the 5 at a place called San Silmar. It's in the San Fernando Valley. And this is it's the largest underground storage facility of natural gas in the country, and it's developed a leak, and they're saying that it could last for 5 months before they fix it. Already 2,200 homes have taken Southern California Gas up on the offer to relocate, go someplace else. They've moved 2 schools to temporary locations already, and you don't really hear about it. And by the way, could I ask somebody to turn the heat down? I don't know why, because you don't want to see me sweat. So it's up there in the foothills there, north of California. Over in Norway, this family who was teaching their children at home and teaching them Christian things, well, sending them to school, they had the children taken away from them, and now the children have been put up for adoption in Norway by the child authorities there. There is no evidence, according to people that have investigated it, and even in the court, that the children had been abused, only that they had been taught Christian things. And a teacher complained, and now the kids have been removed from the parents. So, and I'm going to ask somebody again to check on that thermostat, because it is really, really hot up here. The Pope. Now, you remember the Pope back in September when he was in Philadelphia, I think it was, he said in a mass that the cross was a failure. Remember that? And a lot of people on the Christian side, they got all up in arms. Oh, no, he just meant it from a human standpoint. So the Pope, a transcript was released this week of a talk that the Pope gave in Kenya or Nigeria back in November, and he said this: when you don't understand something, when desperation hits you, you then look at the cross. That is the great failure of God. That is the destruction of God, and it's a challenge to our faith. Now, I don't know how many times a guy has to say something before you really believe what he said. And so the question is, does he really believe this? And I would say the answer to that question is the Pope Catholic. In Saudi Arabia, a big thing going on. Front page of the New York Times this morning, also the Independent. In London, they executed, as somebody said, the Saudi Arabian government went all ISIS on Saudi Arabia. And on people in Saudi Arabia, including one of the leading Shiite clerics. One of the leading Shiite clerics was executed, beheaded. Some were beheaded, some were shot. 47 of them, and now there are protests all over Saudi Arabia, particularly in the Shiite region on the eastern part near the Persian Gulf. That part of Saudi Arabia is majority Shiite. That's the same sect of Islam that is followed in Iran. A form of Shiite Islam is also what the governing, the person who still claims to be the governor of Syria, Assad, follows. He's an Alawite, but it's sort of a subsect of Shiism, is my understanding. And now a lot of people are wondering whether the Saudi Arabian royal family can survive this execution. It's really the first big execution that they've done like this in over 30 years. So it's a pretty significant event, and now people are wondering, is Saudi Arabia destabilized? So we have all of the Arab Spring. Really, none of those countries have come back. Egypt has put in a little bit more pro-Western, more of a realist in power, who has attacked some of the Islamic extremists in his own country. But for the most part, the Middle East remains to be in meltdown. In our own country, the other day, there was this revelation in the Wall Street Journal, a headline, and it said this: U.S. spying nabs allies. It's a pretty significant story. Here's just a little clip from Fox News about what was discovered.
The House Oversight Committee is demanding the NSA respond to questions about recent allegations the spy agency intercepted private communications between the Israeli government and members of Congress during heated lobbying to stop the Iran nuclear deal. Chairman Jason Chaffetz and National Security Subcommittee Chairman Ron DeSantis, both Republicans, sent a letter to NSA Director Admiral Michael Rogers requesting documents and information by January 13th and a full briefing to committee staff by January 15th.
They were doing it to try to get more information passed along to the White House so that the White House could then use that in the political battle inside the Congress about whether this deal should be approved or not. So it's a complete misuse of the intelligence gathering capability of the executive branch.
2 years ago, President Obama said the NSA would no longer spy on America's allies in the wake of the Edward Snowden revelations unless there's a compelling national security purpose. The spying continued as the White House suspected Israel's Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu and his aides may be the source of leaks to Congress about the talks with Iran. Israel's Intelligence and Transport Minister Yisrael Katz urged his government to file a formal protest with the White House.
They have a right to be concerned about the fact that while some leaders around the world are no longer being targeted, one of our strongest ally in the Middle East, Israel, is. These are all concerns and they're legitimate.
But this is a real problem because it's a real invasion of our privacy. But you can see how it would stifle speech if you're going to eavesdrop on congressmen, and that it might stifle what they say or who they communicate with.
Meantime, tension with Iran continues to escalate. The USS Harry S. Truman began airstrikes in the Gulf just days after an Iranian missile boat fired multiple unguided rockets just 1,500 yards from the aircraft carrier after it passed through the narrow Strait of Hormuz. Just days before the U.S. is slated to lift billions in sanctions as part of the nuclear deal, today the U.S. Treasury decided to impose new sanctions on Iran for two ballistic missile tests it carried out in October and November in breach of U.N. Security Council resolutions.
The response from Iran's president today, he ordered his defense minister to expedite the program. Ed?
Jennifer Griffin at the Pentagon. Thank you, Jennifer.
Well, Iran's really on board with that agreement that they've never signed, by the way, that they've never really approved. I am telling you, folks, as I watch what's going on in our government, we've had a soft coup. There's no doubt about this. Okay? This is out of control. Somebody needs to do something about it. I don't know that there's the gumption, the fortitude exists for the opposition party to do anything. They capitulate on everything. And frankly, if I was in charge, every Republican would have been back in Washington the next day after these revelations about the NSA. But I'm not in charge, so I guess they all had tickets to football games. Caroline Glick looked at this in her column Friday in the Jerusalem Post, and she said this. I'm out of order here for some reason. Let me find my Caroline Glick quotes. Okay. As the criminal activity was characterized by the report to protect Obama's nuclear talks with the Iranians, Netanyahu is marked as a top intelligence target for the NSA. The NSA monitored all of his communications, most of his senior officials, most notably Ambassador Ron Dermer. The report explains that the NSA's targeting of Israeli leaders and officials also swept up the contents of some of their private conversations with U.S. lawmakers and American Jewish groups. That raised fears of an oh-you-know-what moment. One senior U.S. official said that the executive branch would be accused of spying on Congress. That moment didn't make the administration pull back or order the NSA to follow the law and destroy all communications between Israeli officials and U.S. lawmakers. Rather, the administration decided to suffice with winks and nods to make sure that the NSA understood that it should make law-breaking an official policy and continue to share deliberately the communications it had mistakenly shared with the White House. The picture painted by the journal article is of an administration that made massive, continuous, and deliberate use of intercepted conversations between lawmakers and private citizens with Israeli officials. Look, in the end times, governments will become lawless, okay? Our administration is lawless. They'll never prosecute. You think the Obama-run Justice Department is going to file criminal charges against anybody over this? The only thing that they'll come out is with pardon recommendations, one of which will include Hillary. Can you imagine what's going to happen if Hillary Clinton gets in charge? Look, this is judgment on America. Consider the administration's indignant fury when news broke on January 21st last year that the Republican congressional leaders, Mitch McConnell and John Boehner, had invited Netanyahu to address the joint houses about the dangers of the Iran nuclear deal. Remember how upset Obama was? Remember the snit he went into, the little snit, the big snit that he went into? Obama and his advisors insisted that they were blindsided by the news. Yet on Wednesday, the journal published a report that strongly indicated that through its spying on lawmakers, the White House learned of the plan to invite Netanyahu to speak before Congress before Netanyahu found out about it. They're liars. Since we know that the NSA was monitoring all of Dermer's communications, including his communications with U.S. lawmakers, it appears to follow that the NSA intercepted Boehner's call to Dermer. According to the journal, the White House's demand for intelligence on Israel was so intense that the NSA was transferring transcripts of intercepted calls within 6 hours of their interception. 2 weeks after Netanyahu's March 4th address before the joint houses of Congress, the journal reported that the U.S. was concerned about Israeli spying on the nuclear talks with Iran. The article began soon after the U.S. and other major powers entered negotiations last year with Iran. Senior White House officials learned Israel was spying on the closed-door talks. Imagine that. Spying on talks about a country that's threatened to blow you off the planet. And supposedly our biggest ally in the Middle East. Not to the people in charge. It ought to go without saying that the administration's massive efforts to block information about the most radical U.S. foreign policy initiative since World War II from U.S. lawmakers speaks volumes about how Obama and his colleagues assessed the public's position on Iran generally and Obama's nuclear talks with the Mollocracy specifically. The nuclear deal with Iran endangers the U.S. directly. It empowers the world's largest state sponsor of terrorism financially, diplomatically, and militarily. Iran declared war against the U.S. 37 years ago and has been calling for the destruction of America and supporting terrorist attacks against the U.S. and its allies ever since. Yet rather than reconsider a strategic goal of courting Iran at the expense of its own national security and that of its closest allies, the Obama administration determined that its most urgent goal was to scuttle Israeli attempts to warn lawmakers and the U.S. public about the dangers of the deal. Rather than redouble its efforts commitment to preventing Iran from acquiring nuclear weapons, the Obama administration launched an intensive espionage operation against Israel, its American Jewish supporters, and U.S. lawmakers to diminish their ability to prevent the deal from being concluded or implemented. With each passing day, it becomes clear that Netanyahu was right about the danger of the deal, and Obama was wrong and deliberately misleading. 4 months later, Iran still refuses to approve or implement the deal. The American hostages it holds continue to languish in its prisons. Its nuclear sites remain closed to international inspectors. Its ballistic missile program is moving forward, and no one takes seriously the administration's announcement this week that it will pursue sanctions at the UN Security Council against Iran for its recent ballistic missile tests. For its part, Iran is so emboldened by the deal last week that it shot a missile across the Straits of Hormuz in close proximity, and at the speed those go, 1,500 yards is nothing. It's less than a mile. The Ayatollahs are convinced that Obama will suffer any and all indignities to keep up the fiction that he has a nuclear deal with them. They are certain that rather than acknowledge his mistake, Obama will ground Congress and Israel to the ground. And yet now, as Iran daily humiliates Obama with its unbridled aggression, that senior administration officials chose to brag to Wall Street Journal reporters about how they spied on Israel in breach of Obama's pledge not to spy on leaders of U.S. allied nations. It is now, when Obama's opening to Iran is a self-evident failure, that they chose to share how they broke U.S. law by spying on U.S. citizens and abused the president's constitutional authority by spying on U.S. lawmakers. Israelis reasonably concentrate their attention on how stories affect them, so most of the discussion in Israel following the Journal's report on Wednesday revolved around what the story means for the prospect of better relations with the administration in its final year in power. But in truth, the story wasn't really about Israel. It was about an administration so contemptuous of U.S. lawmakers and citizens that its senior officials have no compunction about admitting that they are breaking the law. Oh, I wish we had 1,000 Caroline Glicks. You know, pray for her salvation, really. Because in a sense, she speaks prophetically, you know? We're going to talk about that at the end. They brazenly admit that they are undertaking unlawful spying operations against private citizens and lawmakers, and in doing so, conducting a massive abuse of presidential powers while trampling the spirit and arguably the letter of the U.S. Constitution. And they expect that no one call them to task for it. Unfortunately, I think that prophecy may come true. Pressure continues to mount on Israel. This week in Tehran, or in Tel Aviv, a man walked into a market. Here's a report from NBC about what happened.
Good evening. Police and residents remain on high alert tonight as the manhunt for a gunman accused of opening fire on a busy Tel Aviv street enters now its second day. The man's father today imploring the 31-year-old to turn himself in as his family home is raided. Two people were killed and several wounded in that attack on Friday. One of the major questions tonight, why? Keir Simmons has the latest developments.
Panic moments after the Tel Aviv attack, and more than 24 hours later, the killer is still at large. Identified by police as 31-year-old Nasat Melam, he'd been arrested before, seen here in court in 2007. One witness from New York says the hunt to find him began within minutes.
We saw people get out of their cars and run towards the action. Some of them grabbed their guns.
In new surveillance footage today, people dive for cover. A child plays until someone scrambles to pull the youngster to safety. While footage on Israeli media appears to show the killer coolly walking down the street, pretending to shop in a grocery store, then firing more than 15 rounds. The family home of the suspect, an Arab Israeli, was raided today. His brother arrested. His own dad alerted police.
Eventually,
I am deeply sorry, he says. His son was mentally unstable, he claims. Or was he inspired by ISIS? A computer was seized from the home.
It requires an in-depth search as to the possibility that it may be ISIL.
For the victims, a candlelight vigil. One group had been celebrating a birthday until the lives of Alan Bakal, 26, and Shimon Rumi, 30, were ended in cold blood. An unbelievably vicious murder of young people, Israel's prime minister called it, vowing increased law enforcement in Arab areas, a move that risks heightening tensions in Israel. With police standing guard tonight at a murder scene where the killer smiled as he pulled the trigger.
Tomorrow, funerals will be held for the two men murdered, while tonight there is still no sign of their killer and no clear motive has been established. Israeli police are looking at intelligence while special forces are helping the manhunt. The fear is he may attack again. Erica?
And then this front page of the Jerusalem Post the other day, Hamas reported ready to resume suicide attacks. And then this morning in the Jerusalem Post, this front page article, the Israeli Defense Force is preparing for ISIS advance to the Golan border. Well, there's really nothing to worry about, folks, because it is under, the UN is in complete control of everything. In fact, they, the other recently, and this was not really reported much in the press, adopted 48 texts in total as it takes action on reports of its second committee. One of those was this. I can't remember the number of the resolution, but it says this. This is what it's supposed to be. You see parts of it here. Permanent sovereignty of the Palestinian people and the occupied Palestinian territory, including East Jerusalem, and of the Arab population in the occupied Syrian Golan over their natural resources. Because, of course, this is the most important thing when people are being machine gunned down in cafes on a street in Tel Aviv. The world is out of control. You know that if you study Bible prophecy. This week there are a lot of predictions that are coming out about what's the world going to be like in 2016. This is the cover of the special publication that The Economist sends out. I have a copy at home. And here's a little bit of close-up of things that people that they think will be significant in 2016. Now, what bothers me is you start with Angela Merkel in the middle and you go one to her right. I don't see any of the other guys running for office that are up there. And well, the interesting thing is, in this morning's, and I'll just share a few of these, in this morning's Jerusalem Post were 16 predictions for 2016. Now, I'm not going to go in, I'm not going to pull out all the texts of Bible prophecy because you've been around here for a long time. And, you know, if you go back and listen to some of the stuff I've done, you'll find all those texts referenced in detail because I have some other things this morning that are very important. But put these in the context of what you understand about Bible prophecy. Wars in the Middle East, wars around the world, lawlessness, a coming world leader. Okay? Now, one of them, I will say, tries to be a little bit humorous, but it also picks up some truth. Number 16 in the list was, Cubs World Series victory preempts the Messiah. The biggest championship drought in American sports history will also end in 2016. The movie Back to the Future 2 predicted a Chicago Cubs World Series victory in 2015. They came a lot closer than anyone predicted. And see the last paragraph there? There were those who predicted that the Messiah and peace in the Middle East would come before a Cubs World Series victory, but the Cubs will speed ahead of the Messiah. And as for peace in the Middle East, it is doubtful anyone will be making that predictions anytime soon. Although I think there will be a false peace. It'll be a false peace, but there's a peace coming. But look at some of the other predictions. I think this man is very insightful. In fact, one of them that he picks up, I think you will find absolutely stunning, and following one that is deeply disturbing. You'll see those when I get to them. Removal of sanctions makes no difference to Iranians. We're seeing that one already play out before the ink dries on the paper that this was printed on. The Middle East spreads around the world. An international community that did not make much of an effort to end violence in the Middle East will see continual global exports of Middle Eastern terrorism. And look at this. You remember the picture I put up a couple weeks ago? The guy I saw in the downtown streets of Columbus, Ohio, with the baklava, the face mask on, in the middle of the day, walking down the downtown street, taking pictures of buildings. Tactics used by Palestinian terrorists against Israel will continue to be adopted by jihadi elements abroad. Countries have condemned Israel for responding disproportionately to stabbings, shootings, and vehicular terrorism will face stabbings, terrorism, and vehicular terrorism. Or stabbing, shootings, and vehicular terrorism. Look, it's why I didn't get out of the car until the guy was far enough away from me. You may not believe this, but I don't move like I used to. I still can get around, but four artificial joints have pretty much made sprinting not an option. But I can knock you down, maybe. But this is coming. Personally, that's why I didn't get out of the car when I saw that guy. The Syrian civil war intensifies. There's nobody. Is there anybody left? You know, the country had 21 million people when it started. They're probably over 300,000 dead now. I mean, how many died in the United States Civil War? Was it, 600,000? I think a country that had a bigger population than Syria did at the time. It's a stunning total. And over half the people are displaced. And I think that's grossly underestimated. Putin's power progresses. Well, I don't think Russia has anything to do with Bible prophecy. I'm not even bringing in the Turkey stuff that I read this week because I just don't have time. This is the one. Hillary Clinton elected U.S. president. Now enough Americans will decide that there should be a woman president to carry her to the White House. So that's that one. But here's the other one. Obama selected as U.N. Secretary General. Bonnke's term as the 8th Secretary General will conclude on December 31, 2016, just in time for Obama to take over the following month. Now, a lot of people think Obama's not leaving office, and this is my response. I'm not putting a label on him, other than he seems to be an indicator of what's coming, okay? But I think he'll leave office, because to him and his ego, I think the United States is small potatoes. He has bigger designs. Just the United States. Took care of them. Didn't even have to miss a golf game to do it. So, interesting also in today's Jerusalem Post or the other day, see this teaching down here, Parshat Shmot. Why was the redemption delayed? In this concluding paragraph, this unfortunate, it talked about when Moses killed the Egyptian, he was turned in by other Jews. He saw an injustice being done, and he took care of it, and he was turned in by other Jews. And this rabbi, this is the chief rabbi of the Western Wall, the Kotel. This unfortunate and strange phenomenon of Jews acting against their own nation requires a deep analysis down to the roots of this issue. But we can learn this from the Torah portion. And this is the Torah portion that they're going to be reading here in this week or next. Even if those informers managed to delay the liberation from slavery by decades, they did not have the power to prevent it entirely. They had the ability to disturb, but not to truly change the course of history. Ultimately, the Jewish nation was liberated from Egypt despite those Jews who preferred to stay there. After all, we believe the course of history is determined not by kings, presidents, or heads of state, but rather by God. This faith offers us hope that despite all the hardships, history will progress towards its promised state to the time when, quote, "It shall be at the end of days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be firmly established at the top of the mountains, and shall be raised above the hills, and all the nations shall stream to it. Nation shall not lift sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore." It's an interesting comment from a Jewish rabbi. The secular press, though, is into this. This is a stunning thing. I had not had a chance to look at it before last week. So this is the current issue of Time magazine. Adele, I guess she's a singer, I've heard. I don't think I've ever heard it. I don't listen to music much anymore, just because there's so much going on to try to keep up with. But this is the article in the Time magazine. Now look at the picture. It's four horses. You see four, there's actually six horses there, but you see four horses of different colors. Are they trying, is that a reference to something? And then the title of the article, there are the four horses, "The Absence of International Leadership Will Shape a Tumultuous 2016. The world is dying for someone to come and take control of this mess. Time is as mainstream media as you get. And look at the quotes at the end of the article. This is the how it ends. "But none of these good news stories," it talks about some good things going on in the world. And believe me, I read the article, they're a bit of a stretch. But, they talked about, well, there's going to be some policy corrections in Brazil and Argentina. Well, that's really working great. Brazil is at economic collapse. They have cities that barely have water to survive. But none of these good news stories will help resolve the G0 dilemma. It concludes. "Only a global emergency on a scale greater than anything we've yet seen can accomplish that. The sort of crisis that forces a new level of global cooperation based on the world's true balance of power. It might be a war, a financial crisis." I wonder if he's watching our stuff. "A public health threat, a catastrophic terrorism, an environmental disaster." Could be all the above, that somebody said. "Though that crisis is approaching, we're unlikely to get there in 2016. But this, when it finally comes, it will be the biggest story of our time." Do you think that the world is set up for the 70th week of Daniel? It's not, it's teed up high and it's ready to go. We have this House bill that was introduced. I think I mentioned this last week. I only mentioned this to set up the next, because now I'm going to talk about false teaching in the church, and this is what we're going to talk about the rest of the time. And we will go a little bit over today, so if you have to leave, please feel free to do so. Just get up and go. I don't have a lunch reservation until 2, so I have all afternoon. But I won't go that much over. I will do as much as normal. This is the House resolution introduced by 82 Democrats on December 17th, talking about shutting down anti-Muslim rhetoric and hate speech. Now, this is just a resolution, but these things, if they get through, generally become law. So you need to know that this is the plan of what the Democrats want. And right now, I'm concerned because I don't see anybody stopping them from doing anything. Now, it's in committee. It may not get out. But it talks about anti-Muslim rhetoric. So now let's go to the National Youth Workers Convention. And I'll say, I don't know if I should say his name or not. A friend, I got the audio. He put together a great video of Tony Campolo's talk. So I want you to listen to this. This is what's being taught at a National Youth Workers Convention. Mainstream evangelicals send their youth workers to this thing all the time. They draw thousands of people to two different conferences each year. It was the first weekend in December down in Louisville. And here's a little video that my friend Dan put together about what Tony said. "And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them." Shahada, the Muslim profession of faith. "There is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is the messenger of Allah." The headbands had that emblazoned on them, by the way. Here's Tony Campolo speaking at the National Youth Workers Convention. Founder of the Red Letter Christian Movement, national speaker and author of over 35 books. Received a Lifetime Achievement Award from the National Youth Workers Convention. The title of his talk was A Biblical Case for Multiculturalism.
Incidentally, you'd better learn that. Because you saw what happened in Maui. Because you saw what happened in Maui, says Prophet. Incidentally,
hang on here.
There is one God, Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet. Incidentally, you'd better learn that. Because you saw what happened in Maui. Those who could recite that didn't get shot. So it'd be useful to learn that. There's one God, Allah, and the word Allah means God. So don't get upset. You're not worshiping a strange God. There's one God, Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet. Be sure to be ready to say that when they point the gun at you.
Makes no difference. That's God is Allah. Allah is God. They're the same. By the way, if you're going to learn, you better learn in Arabic. I don't think English is going to save you. And he goes through some verses with from the Quran, some principles from the Quran. Contrary to what Jesus has said, that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father.
You know, here's the thing. A lie is very useful. Or as my mother used to say, a lie is an abomination to God and a very present help in trouble.
These are not taken out of context. This is exactly what he said at the National Youth Workers Convention. A lie, it's very helpful. He has a Lifetime Achievement Award.
I don't know that you're disowning Jesus. If you feel that that's a disowning of Jesus, then I think you'd have to back off.
An audience member says, but I think that the intention with the Muslim being there pointing the gun at you, they would think that you're accepting what they believe.
I think you've got a point. And perhaps that whole, I mean, if Donald Trump can backtrack, I can backtrack. Don't say the prayer. Let him shoot you. And the sooner the better, I say, the sooner the better.
Just a big joke, isn't it? He's the evangelical leader. You'll be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endures to the end shall be saved. But look at how, this is what passes for stuff in the Christian church. This is a pastor preaching in an evangelical church in America, and what are they doing while he's preaching? Giving somebody a tattoo. What are they going to do next to draw the crowd? I don't care if the guy preached the truth, okay? This is an abomination. It really is. That they would stoop this low. Now, this past week, was Urbana 2015. It's called Urbana, but it's held in St. Louis now. It used to be held in Champaign on the University of Illinois campus. A lot of sponsors of this thing, including, you see down in the lower right-hand corner, Sojourners, Christians for Biblical Equality. Wouldn't take you too much to figure out what they're about. This used to be a great evangelistic outreach for InterVarsity, missions training, and that type of thing. So here's the book recommendation from December 28th. This is what we think everybody should go read. This is really important.
It's called Redeeming Sex.
Redeeming Sex.
Conversations about sex, sexuality, and gender are everywhere. You can hardly go a day without encountering it in some sphere of your life. However, in Redeeming Sex, Deb Hirsch offers some of the most honest and real reflections on sex that I have ever read. She presents a path to help the church better understand our missteps in explaining and understanding sex and sexuality, and helps us begin to restore the relationship with the LGBT community.
I talked about Deb Hirsch earlier this summer. Why? She spoke at the National Fellowship of Grace Brethren Churches National Conference. The title of her talk was Redeeming Sex. You want to know her orientation? This is where she's coming. This was near the conclusion of her talk.
One of the bigger issues, a broader issue that we have to address is our idolatry of the construct of what we call the nuclear family. Because that is not the understanding of God's family. And I don't have time to go into that with you.
Praise the Lord, she didn't have time to go into that nonsense. We have to get over our idolatry of the nuclear family. The one that Jesus endorsed in the Gospels. A man shall leave father and mother and cleave unto his wife, and the two shall be one flesh. You mean that? That's idolatry to talk about that? Are you kidding me? And this stuff is tolerated by people who should know better. And it needs to stop. Of course, the Twitter feed was all lit up on December 28th because the main talk there was about already loving how the worship team is wearing Black Lives Matter t-shirts. And there they are. Sojourners, a left-wing Marxist rag, if you ever talked about one, InterVarsity backs Black Lives Matter at Urbana. It was fantastic. Sojourners earlier in the year when the Supreme Court decision came down, nuking traditional marriage, Christian leaders in U.S. voiced support for SCOTUS marriage. Praise the Lord that they finally got rid of that old biblical thing. And these are the people that love what's going on at InterVarsity's national conference. Here's the news report. InterVarsity Christian Fellowship is an evangelical college ministry that is no stranger to social justice movements. Still, it was surprising for InterVarsity to devote an evening at its Urbana Missions Conference to Black Lives Matter. InterVarsity unabashedly called on 16,000 students to support the movement. What InterVarsity did last night was more than a nod to current events or this need to oppose racism. It was a full-throated, unapologetic call to support Black Lives Matter. This Twitter or tweet came out from Urbana Missions. Are we comfortable? Are we people who can enter into the uncomfortable Black Lives Matter? Talk given by Michelle, I don't remember her name. Here's a little bit of what she had to say.
What? An old lady ago. It wasn't even that long ago. That's one old woman ago who put some Japanese people in a camp and said, you might be a terrorist. Don't lie. Don't play with me. If you don't know your history, you're going to end up repeating it with a crazy A president who don't know what he's doing. What do we want? Justice. And what is justice? Justice means my baby boy, my baby girl will not be tried, condemned, sentenced, and executed on the street. That is justice. We can wipe out the adoption crisis tomorrow. We could wipe it out this week. But we're too busy arguing to have abortion banned. We're too busy arguing to defund Planned Parenthood. We are too busy withholding mercy from the living so that we might display a big spectacle of how much we want mercy to be shown to.
She got a standing ovation at the end. Let me fast forward to the end because I want you to just hear the last little bit of this. She talks about, she quotes the Bible, faith is the evidence of things not seen, the evidence of things hoped for. So this is how she concludes one aspect of her talk. It might be just a little out of joint, but I think you'll get the point.
Hopes. Angela Davis is still out there hoping with a hot afro. She is hoping.
Angela Davis? How many of you remember Angela Davis? Is Angela Davis somebody that a Christian, young Christian, should idolize? Not in a minute! I'm going to blow my head here today.
Lives Matter is the evidence of things unseen. What?
Black Lives Matter is evidence of things unseen. That's how she concluded. And she got a big standing ovation. One lady tweeted, we just chanted a Black Lives Matter protest, chanted Obama. Thank you, Jesus. And I'm not going to play you that. But this stuff is out of control. This is a conference coming up in Orlando called Synergize 2016. Ravi Zacharias and others will be there, where the church gathers to save the world. Follow up on a 2012 conference from the same organization at Palm Beach Atlantic University that was really started by Bill Hybels and others. Cokie Roberts was at that conference. And this is what they say. A billion people something is their phrase. Billion.tv is about doubling the number of Christians in the next 10 to 15 years and striving to finish the Great Commission by AD 2100. Warren Wiersbe says the mind is not a debating hall but a picture gallery. Once the mind has been shaped by a new idea, it will never return to its original shape. Likewise, once the heart is shaped by a new vision, to retract it is never sad. This is all part of New Apostolic Reformation stuff. This is false teaching. And all these guys are running down there to join in, and their real phrase that they talk about and their vision is bring back the king. We're going to do such a good job that Jesus will come back. That's never been the mission of the church. It never will be the mission of the church. If it was the mission of the church, for 2,000 years, the church has been a miserable failure at it. Because no place on planet Earth has anything approximating the kingdom of God been established. That ought to maybe lead one to a conclusion that maybe that's not the mission of the church. Now, that doesn't mean we're not supposed to do things and do good and put structures in place. It's not what I'm saying. But this whole belief, this dominionist belief, is based on the fact that we're going to bring back the king. We're going to make society so perfect that Jesus will have no choice but to come back. And they jump on us for talking about Bible prophecy. They're false teachers. It goes worse at IHOP. Until the fame of Jesus fills the earth, Mike Bickle, a false prophet. There he was doing the keynote address, was Ronnie Floyd, the president. The president of the Southern Baptist Convention. Well, I don't have time to go into this, but Mike Bickle was part of the Kansas City Prophets, came up in the late 80s, was part of the Vineyard movement. John Wimber, the founder of the Vineyard, heavily endorsed it. It was Mike Bickle, Paul Kane, Bob Jones. They all came out of the Kansas City Fellowship. They went to England. They prophesied, England's going to turn around, and it's going to be the most wonderful place, and it's going to have a great revival. As my friend Jacob says, they've had more mosques built in England since those guys came than churches. And it's true. They prophesied, and it was false. What does that make them? False prophet. And there was also another speaker, popular in evangelical circles, spoke the other day, Francis Chan.
But he's saying, no, I'm not talking about the people out there. He goes, in the church. And that's the same thing that Paul's saying here in Timothy, to Timothy in 2 Timothy 3. He goes, man, you need to avoid this. At the end, it's going to get terrible. Not because of what happens out there, but because of what happens in here. I mean, it's a message that the world is teaching. I mean, even sociologists are saying that this is the most narcissistic generation in the history of the world. By a long shot.
And look, I don't disagree with that. I've said that myself. But not at IHOP. There's a difference. And we're going to talk about that in just a moment. You need to understand just a little bit more about these Kansas City prophets. Aside from strange prophecies and visions, the Kansas City prophets reported visits to the supernatural realms, including heavens, in a series of 5-hour-long tapes entitled Visions and Revelations. Mike Bickle and Bob Jones are heard wowing followers of the Kansas City Fellowship with all sorts of tales of their unverified experiences in the next plane. I suppose Bob Jones took the trip between using his prophetic gift to get women to disrobe in his office. But that didn't stop him. In 2008, I sound like Jacob, don't I? That didn't stop him. In 2008, Bob Jones went down to Lakeland for the great Todd Bentley, the Lakeland Revival. Remember that mess? And he prophesied on June 22nd, 2008, this is going to be great. And then the next day, this happened. Video for the outpouring.
My name is Peter Wagner, and I'm president of Global Harvest Ministries based in Colorado Springs, Colorado. I have served the body of Christ in apostolic ministry for many years, and currently I preside over the International Coalition of Apostles, which brings together over 500 recognized apostles. I have the honor of being assigned to preside over this momentous occasion, and I am humbled as I approach the task with an enormous sense of awe. Todd is following Paul's example by inviting to the platform three apostolic pillars of today's church. Cheyenne of Pasadena, California.
False.
Bill Johnson of Redding, California.
Double false.
And John Arnott of Toronto, Canada.
Really false.
With this affirmation, we will move to a formal commissioning.
There they are, Bill, Cheyenne, and John Arnott, left
to
right.
Hand of fellowship as the three apostles did to Paul in Jerusalem. This commissioning represents a powerful spiritual transaction taking place in the invisible world. With this in mind, I take the apostolic authority that God has given me, and I decree to Todd Bentley, your power will increase. Your authority will increase. Your favor will increase. Your influence will increase. Your revelation will increase. I also decree that a new supernatural strength will flow through this ministry. A new life force will penetrate this move of God. Government will be established to set things in their proper order. God will pour out a higher level of discernment to distinguish truth from error. New relationships will...
Folks, this is one of the most absurd things I have ever seen in my life. You heard the great founder of the New Apostolic Reformation, the former head of Fuller Seminary, by the way, see Peter Wagner prophesy about how great this was going to be. And now you're going to watch the Kundalini spirit enter the room.
Purpose to open the gates for the future.
There it is.
I mean, it's a miracle that Peter Wagner, Bill Johnson, John Arnott, Todd Bentley, and these distinguished apostles would all be able to make it all together at one time, one place.
Unfortunately, lightning was not in the area.
That's it. With our international commitments, that's a miracle in itself. And I also feel, Todd, significant that two things. One, that this would be on June 23rd. Bob Jones prophesied that you'll go to a whole different level June 22nd. Remember that? So here's the day after. And you're going to a whole different level. Isaiah 22:22. He's giving you the keys of David. He's opening doors that no man can close. And so it's very, very significant that this is taking place. We, as your brothers and your friends.
I think doors are being opened in this meeting. I'm just preparing.
We have a deep love for you, Shauna, your whole family. We just esteem you. We are here to stand with you, to support you. And we are here to commission you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, in the power of Jesus' name, with special oil from Chuck Pierce. It's called Revival Oil. Chuck could not make it, but he sent this FedEx special oil for you.
Oh, and Chuck Pierce, I think he probably sent it COD.
He's in Africa, and so we anoint you and commission you in Jesus' name. Wow! Oh! Wow! Boom!
Now here's some more problems.
We shape the course of history by part.
That's Bill Johnson of Reading. Whoops.
We shape the course of history by partnering with you, giving honor where it's due. You welcome the glory as well as anybody I've ever seen in my life. I long to learn from you in that. And I bless you, and I pray with the rest of these that the measure of glory would increase, that Moses would no longer be considered the high watermark where the glory shone from his face, but instead the revelation of the goodness of God would change the face of the church, and that he would use your voice, he would use your grace, your anointing, to alter the face of the church before this world, that the goodness of the Lord would be seen once again. I pray this over you in Jesus' name.
For the Lord would say unto thee that this day you have loosened upon this earth, yea, what I have wanted for centuries to come forth, a kingly anointing which will bring in money, money, money.
What?
Money, money, money.
Really?
Money, money, money.
Todd, the Spirit of God says years from now, people will look at this time and they will recognize it as when their God showed up and created within the church a new heart, says the Lord.
And eat. No longer, no longer, no longer will men
Cindy
call
Jacobs.
Unclean what I have called clean.
One more. You have to see this one. This is a lady gets, I don't know who she is, gets up to prophesy.
You know, the worst state we could ever fall into is lukewarmness. And God has sent you as an antidote for that lukewarm spirit. And the fire has been birthed here. It's been released here. You've unstopped a well. You have other wells to unstop in other cities and other places. This is just the beginning. And there is longevity, too. There is increase, but there is also longevity.
Show me your glory. And it was the very pinnacle prayer of Moses' life. And this prayer.
Okay, that goes on for like 5 minutes. Okay, here's the story, okay? Here's the story. June 23rd, they did this. Longevity, money, 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 a great anointing. I'll learn from you. This is fantastic. You and Shauna and the family. Remember the one guy said that, Shayon? What happened? September, the ministry announced that Todd was taking some time off. He left his disabled wife and family and ran off with one of the revival workers, divorced his wife and married her. So are any one of these guys a true prophet? No. Now listen, this stuff is invading the church. It still goes on. And I know I'm going to get a lot of stuff from the Bethel people. Oh, you just don't understand. Baloney! Okay? These are false, demonstrably false prophets. They have marked themselves with that tag. Not me. You saw the video. You know the facts. Make up your own minds whether they're a true or false prophet. I think you can only come to one conclusion. But people that point, and this, there's some things going on in the Bible prophecy and discernment community right now. I'm not at liberty to share, but I'm setting this up as some things that may come out in the next few days, okay? So just pay attention. We may be publishing some things. We'll send out links when it comes about. But people are standing up against false teaching in the prophecy community. They've been in touch with me. We spent hours on the phone talking and praying about how to respond to this because, in my view, what is going on has the potential to be a discernment crisis in the evangelical community of epic proportions. And I believe that that's true. Nathan Leal has put up a webcast. You can look, I think his ministry is called Watchman's Cry, in which I think Nathan did a phenomenal job of talking about this. But now Nathan is being called divisive. Oh, Nathan, you're divisive, you're dividing, you're destroying theological unity. And this is what always happens with false teachers. They come in and they say this, reject a divisive man after the first and second admonition, knowing that such a person is warped and sinning, being self-condemned. Anybody that doesn't go agree with us. Is that what the verse is talking about? Here's James McDonald applying that verse wrongly a few years ago.
Number two, I secretly wish that these two verses...
This is the... He's read Titus 3, 10 and 11. This is at his conference for all of his pastors and leaders.
Were my elders' favorite verses. They're not my life verse, but I wish that my elders had these two verses for their favorites. One's from the pastoral epistles, where it says, reject a factious man after the second admonition. I wish that that was my elder's life verse. How much heartache is caused in a church by elders that forbear for the sake of friendship with a factious man? Reject a factious man after the second admonition. Now, reject him doesn't mean he has to sit halfway back, okay? Reject him means you can't come here anymore. Well, I'm sorry. Okay, that means you get to go to a different church. Reject. Do I need to spell that out? Why? That's so cold. It's so wise. How much heartache I could have saved our church over the last two decades if I had lowered my expectation of my ability to change the behavior of others and raised my expectation that people will be as they have been. A factious man is a danger to the church, and you are released by Scripture to release him. And I'm releasing you to take a small portion of your church's budget, build a catapult, put it in the church parking lot, and load it regularly. I think we can shoot this one right out of our county.
Now listen, he was wrong when he said that, and I'll show you why. Now, to his credit, the elders of that church, or the executive elders, whatever they called them, they kicked guys out of the church. It was very public. I played the video in the class I used to teach. You might remember it. And James McDonald has repented of that, okay? But he was wrong in the application. Divisive there comes from the word hereticos. Anybody have a guess as to what hereticos means? Heretic, the divisive, factious person in Scripture is not the one who is standing for the truth. It is a work of Satan. And I do mean it is a work of Satan that has flipped that verse into something that it does not mean. People who stand for the truth by the very definitions in Scripture cannot be divisive. And so if we ever get off track around here and somebody comes up and says, you guys are all messed up, we need to talk about it, I pray that we will be humble enough to do that. And you probably should go pull out January 3rd. Maybe we can put that in the permanent archives of what Pastor Steve calls the Department of Corrections. And in Romans 16, it talks about that. I urge you, brethren, to note those who cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you learned. Avoid them. For those who do such, those who are such do not serve our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by smooth words and flattering speech deceive the hearts of the simple. And the divisions there is the Greek word dikostasia, dichotomy, division. But it's not disagreement. Because the next part of the verse tells you what it is. It becomes from what? Contrary to the doctrine which you learn. And so when you see videos out there now talk about, oh, we need to get over ourselves about theological unity, that's not based on Scripture. Sad to say. But it's time to correct this in the church. Email PastorSteve@fbchapel.com. Well, our friend Jacob spoke at a Calvary Chapel in Hawaii in 2001. And Pastor Steve, I see he's done with his class. Were you on staff at this church? Okay, well, he worked at this church. So here's a little bit of intro from Jacob, and this is going to go about 20 minutes probably. I apologize for going over, but I think this is really, really, really important to lay a foundation for the things that are going on so that you understand the biblical way to respond to the things that you'll see. And if you listen to Nathan's thing, okay? So here's Jacob speaking at Calvary Chapel, this introduction. The video quality is pretty poor, but I think you'll get, and it might be out of sync a little bit, but you'll get the point.
You know, we know there's four Gospels, but most Christians forget that you have the same kind of thing in the Old Testament. When the Holy Spirit gives us more than one account of something in the Bible, it's important. And we forget the same as you have four Gospels. Well, in the Old Testament, you'll have Kings and Chronicles, two aspects of the same thing, plus whatever prophet or prophets prophesied during that time. So you will similarly have three and four aspects of the same episodes in the Old Testament, just as you have in the Gospels. When the Holy Spirit gives us more than one record of something, it's important. Turn with me, please, to 2 Chronicles chapter 18. This is the parallel account to what we find in 1 Kings 22, but we're reading now from 2 Chronicles chapter 18.
And here's what the passage that he reads from is. Now Jehoshaphat had great riches and honor, and he allied himself by marriage with Ahab. Ahab had a wonderful wife, didn't he? Some years later, he went down to visit Ahab in Samaria, and Ahab slaughtered many sheep and oxen for him, and the people who were with him, and induced him to go up against Ramoth-Gilead. Ahab, king of Israel, said to Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, "Will you go with me against Ramoth-Gilead?" And he said to him, "I am as you are, and my people as your people, and we will be with you in the battle." Moreover, Jehoshaphat said to the king of Israel, "Please inquire first for the word of the Lord." Let's bring in the prophets. They'll tell us what to do. Then the king of Israel assembled the prophets, 400 men, and said to them, "Shall we go against Ramoth-Gilead to battle, or shall I refrain?" And they said, "Go up, for God will give it to the hand of the king." But Jehoshaphat said, "Is there not yet a prophet of the Lord here that we may inquire of him?" Then the king of Israel said to Jehoshaphat, "There is yet one man, one." So there were 401 prophets. 400 said, "It's okay, it'll be great, everything will be fine. There's yet one man by whom we may inquire of the Lord, but I hate him, for he never prophesies good concerning me, but always evil. He is Micaiah, son of Imla." But Jehoshaphat said, "Let not the king say so." I'm very encouraged, because I can tell by the way, you get this, right? You know where this is going. So let's hear what Jacob had to say. He's going to continue reading in 2 Chronicles 18, if you want to follow along, starting around verse 8.
"I hate him, he never prophesies good. False prophets will always tell people what they want to hear. True prophets will only tell people what they need to hear." Verse 8, then the...
And let me just say, we're truncating what Jacob had to say. I think you'll get the salient points of what he had to say. We will provide a link to the full video and the text of what he had to say, which is on the Moriel website. They'll all be in the comments or the show description that we put up on YouTube. And you should go listen to them. And I think I'll put a place, I think, where you can download a longer version audio. I think it's a very important message. It was titled "A Chink in the Armor." And it was not very, Pastor Steve will tell you, it was not very well received in a lot of quarters, what he had to say. But let me tell you, with what is going on now, this message stands, in my opinion, the test of time as well as any message I have ever heard. You just have to change a few names and everything, and you will be brought up to the current day in the evangelical church. He continues.
The king of Israel called an officer and said, "Bring quickly Micaiah, Imlah's son." Now the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, were sitting each on his throne, arrayed in their robes, and they were sitting at the threshing floor at the entrance of the gate of Samaria, and all the prophets were prophesying before them. And Zedekiah, the son of Chenaanah, made horns of iron for himself, and said, "Thus says the Lord, with these you shall gore the Arameans until they are consumed." And all the prophets were prophesying, thus saying, "Go up to Ramoth Gilead and succeed, for the Lord will give it into the hand of the king." Then the messenger who came to him spoke, saying, "Behold, the words of the prophets are uniformly favorable to the king. So please let your word be like one of them and speak favorably." But Micaiah said, "As the Lord God lives, what my God says, that I will speak." And when he came to the king said to him, "Micaiah, shall we go up to Ramoth Gilead to battle, or shall I refrain?" And he said, "Go up and succeed, for they will be given into your hand." Then the king said to him, "How many times must I adjure you to speak to me nothing but the truth in the name of the Lord?" So he said, "I saw all Israel scattered on the mountains like sheep which have no shepherd." And the Lord said, "These have no master. Let each of them return to his house in peace." Then the king of Israel said to Jehoshaphat, "Did I not tell you that he would not prophesy good concerning me but evil?" And Micaiah said, "Therefore hear the word of the Lord. I saw the Lord sitting on his throne, and all the host of heaven, Hatzevaot HaShemayim, standing on his right and on his left. And the Lord said, 'Who will entice Ahab, king of Israel, to go up and fall at Ramoth Gilead?' And one said this, while another said that. Then a spirit came forward and stood before the Lord and said, 'I will entice him.' And the Lord said to him, 'How?' And he said, 'I will go and be a deceiving spirit in the mouth of all of his prophets.' Then he said, 'You are to go and entice him and prevail also, go and do so. Now, therefore, behold, the Lord has put a deceiving spirit in the mouth of these your prophets, for the Lord has proclaimed disaster against you.' Then Zedekiah, the son of Chenaanah, came near and struck Micaiah on the cheek and said, 'How did the spirit of the Lord pass from me to speak to you?' And Micaiah said, 'Behold, you shall see on that day when you enter an inner room to hide yourself.' Then the king of Israel said, 'Take Micaiah and return him to Ammon, the governor of the city, and to Joash, the king's son, and say, Thus says the king, put this man in prison and feed him sparingly with bread and water until I return safely.' And Micaiah said, 'If you indeed return safely, the Lord has not spoken by me.' And he said, 'Listen, all you people.' So the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, went up against Ramoth Gilead. And the king of Israel said to Jehoshaphat, 'I will disguise myself and go into battle, but you put on your robe.' So the king of Israel dressed himself, and they went into battle. Now the king of Aram had commanded the captains of his chariot, saying, 'Do not fight with small or great, but with the king of Israel alone.' So it came about when the captains of the chariot saw Jehoshaphat that they said, 'It is the king of Israel,' and they turned aside to fight against him. But Jehoshaphat cried out, and the Lord helped him, and God diverted them from him. Then it happened, when the captains of the chariot saw that it was not the king of Israel, that they turned back from pursuing him. And a certain man drew his bow at random and struck the king of Israel in a joint or in a chink of his armor. So he said to the driver of the chariot, 'Turn around and take me out of the fight, for I am severely wounded.' And the battle raged that day, and the king of Israel propped himself up in his chariot in the..." The battle raged that day, and the king of Israel propped himself up in his chariot in front of the Arameans until the evening. And at sunset he died. Then Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, returned in safety to his house in Jerusalem. And Jehu, the son of Hanani, the seer, went out to meet him and said to King Jehoshaphat, "Should you help the wicked and love those who hate the Lord and so bring wrath on yourself? But there's some good in you, for you have removed the Ashtaroth from the land and you have set your heart to seek God." King Jehoshaphat was a good man, a righteous man. Every king of Israel was a backslider. Most of the kings of Judah were backslidden. But Jehoshaphat was a good king. In fact, a very good king. What happens when good leaders become involved with bad ones? I do not believe in guilt by association. I don't believe in guilt by association. The Bible says nothing about guilt by association. But guilt by cooperation, guilt by participation, guilt by identification. When a good man will get on a platform or on a television program with somebody who is heretical, with someone who's apostate or immoral, you are implicitly endorsing that person's ministry and allowing yourself to be identified with him. I was watching some films of the TBN just yesterday. I couldn't believe how horrific some of it was. When an unsaved person watches that, they think being born again is a con job. They've made born again a household joke all over the world, at least all over the developed world. That's what they've done. It's more and more difficult to share Jesus, to preach the gospel, to give the message of salvation to the lost because of what Satan has done with the Christian TV, so-called. We'd be better off with no Christian TV than 99% of what we have today, I'm convinced. Anything that powerful, Satan had to corrupt, and he's done it. Unsaved people see the idiot box, and they think we're all idiots. They think we're all con artists. If a good man goes on there, he becomes identified with the bad man. When Jehoshaphat rode in the chariot of Ahab, he becomes confused with Ahab. But let's look to the beginning. Again, the Holy Spirit has given us more than one account. In the 1 Kings version, at the end of chapter 21, Ahab repented. Bad kings are great for repenting, but every time they repent, they come back twice as notorious as they had been. If Benny Hinn repents again, I'm going to duck for cover. Every time that man repents, he comes back worse. What does this mean? Why? He is married to Jezebel. Jezebel is a biblical metaphor for the spirit of false religion. What does the Lord Jesus say of Jezebel? I have this against you, that you tolerate the woman Jezebel, who seduces my servants. It is a satanic seduction of false religion, of which the woman Jezebel is typologically the personification. In other words, she represents spiritual seduction. That's what Jesus said. You become like the people you're married to. I'm married to a Jewish neurotic. I think it's the family history of escaping pogroms. My wife checks the gas jets 3 times before we go to sleep, and she checks every window in the house at least twice. We live in England. Here it is late at night, put the lights out, and she'll say to me in Hebrew, Yaakov, Adakta etalon be mitbak. Did you check the window in the kitchen? Yes, Pavia, I checked the window in the kitchen. Good night, Lila Tov. Did I check that window in the kitchen? Now she's making me nuts. I take a flashlight down 3 flights of stairs. The kids sleep on the 2nd floor, we sleep on the top, and the kitchen's on the ground floor. There I go late at night. You become like the people you're married to. Well, he is married to Jezebel, the seductress who beguiled Israel into pagan demonic belief. What happens next? Jehoshaphat is a good king, but there's a family connection. A family connection. I've seen this over and over and over, how nepotism. I know 2 Jewish mission boards that were undermined, basically destroyed by nepotism, and 2 mission boards to the Jews. They became family enterprises. I've known churches where family loyalties destroyed the fellowship. If somebody disagreed, it was like going against the family. Dangerous thing. Anything God intends for good, the devil will use for evil, and nepotism predisposes us to certain things. But going back to chapter 18 of 2 Chronicles, here is the line you'll always get. This is what Ahab will say. We have a common enemy. My people are as your people. My God is as your God. We're brothers. We have to have unity. We have to be united to overcome the opposition. Can't you see the abortion rate is going through the roof? Can't you see homosexuality is influencing the schools and the media? Can't you see Eastern religion and the cults are growing? We can't afford to be divided. We have to stand together to save God's land. We have to be united. We can't go on bickering against each other. Oh, I know we've had our differences, but we can't afford that anymore. There's a common enemy. My people are as your people. My God is as your God. After all, we're all born again Christians. Sounds very convincing. Sounds very logical to a degree. It even sounds initially biblical. Initially. But as I pointed out yesterday, the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth, and He is the Spirit of holiness. There cannot be a unity of the Spirit where there is heresy and immorality. Oh, we have a common enemy. An external enemy is easy to deal with. An internal enemy is something else. When Jesus warned about false prophets of the last days, He was not primarily warning about the Moonies or the Jehovah's Witnesses or the Mormons. I have no doubt that the proliferation of cults is in itself of some prophetic significance. But those are not the false prophets He was mainly warning about. He's warning about those who would come in the evangelical church and try to seduce us. It is the internal enemies that are the most dangerous. Until we deal with the enemy in here, we are not going to be in a position to deal with the one out there. But you'll always get the same story. Don't be negative. Don't be too critical. We have to unite. We have to stand together in face of the common threat. And then if a family element comes in, look out. Look how the king ingratiates himself. Ahab puts on a big party, a big splurge. He slaughters all these animals, and he throws a big, big banquet. That's what he does. These people know how to ingratiate themselves. People with an agenda know how to con and manipulate. They learn it from their wife, Jezebel. They know how to manipulate. Look how many people have met Pope John Paul II. The Vatican a few months ago issued a statement saying it was the one true church. In Mexico in 1999, John Paul II told the Catholics to rise up against the Protestants, quote unquote. That's what he said. Makes no secret of his agenda. A man who says Mary co-redeemed us? A man who prays to the dead? Makes no secret of his agenda. Yet one evangelical after another will call him the Holy Father, despite the fact that Jesus said, call no man your father. And say, oh, he was so wonderful, he was so gracious, he's such a kind man. How can you speak against him? I met him, he was so this, he was so that. They know how to ingratiate themselves. What does Paul say about Lucifer? He comes as an angel of light, and so will his servants. They know how to ingratiate themselves. Just like Berodach Baladan came to seduce King Hezekiah, he bought him some presents. I heard you were ill. Oh, what a caring person. He was the king of Babylon. He had an agenda. He was a manipulating con artist. Well, so far, King Jehoshaphat gets sucked in. There's the family connection, but then there's other connections. Yeah, we have a common enemy. We can't be negative. We shouldn't be critical. We don't want to be divisive, quote unquote. This word divisive, you know what the Greek word divisive is? It is in Romans 16, 17. Dikostasia. Get the word dichotomy. It says it's the people who leave the teaching of the New Testament, who depart from the doctrine of the apostles, who are divisive. I'm not divisive by warning about Benny Hinn or Kenneth Copeland. It's the Benny Hinns and Kenneth Copelands who've gone away from the teaching of the New Testament who are divisive by biblical definition. They're the ones who I haven't departed from New Testament doctrine. If I did, please show me where. I want to repent of it. But now it's the one who upholds New Testament doctrine who becomes divisive. They make an idol out of this unity, but it's not the unity of the Spirit. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 11:19, there must be factions among you to prove which is true. That word for factions in Greek is hereses. We get the word heresy. Heresy is meant to bring division. And so much of what's being propagated in the church today is purely heretical. But let's go further. Jehoshaphat gets sucked in, but he has his doubts. He's a good king, and he is to some degree hearing from the Lord. Notice what they do at the banquet. One false prophet after another, 400 of them, come and put on a show and give you positive words. Once more, false prophets will always tell you what you want to hear, not what you need to hear. They'll always tickle your ears and be well paid for the privilege. That's what they are as con men. A true prophet was outnumbered 400 to 1. Well, I'll tell you what. For everybody telling the truth today in the prophetic, there are 400 false prophets in the body of Christ today. That's what Jesus said would happen in the last days, and it is happening. Very few are telling the truth. Many are compromising with what they know is false, but very, very, very many are giving you a lot of hype and false doctrine. Only one man stood up, Micaiah. But at the end of the day, it was only his prophecy who mattered. You see, in the days of Jeremiah and Baruch, there were thousands of false prophets, thousands. But nobody's ever heard of them. At the end of the day, everybody heard of Jeremiah. It is only he who really speaks God's word who's going to matter. The bottom line. The one prophet who tells the truth. So Jehoshaphat says, "Let me hear him." Now you have to understand the Hebrew language. There's a connection between the name Micaiah, he who was like unto Yahweh, and Jehoshaphat, Yehoh Micaiah. Yehoh is Jehovah, Micaiah, Yah is Yahweh. In Hebrew there's a root. It shows something of an entomological similitude. If you know what that is, if you don't worry about it. It's one of those things they teach you in theological seminary. There's a kindred spirit of some sort here. Micaiah comes. Now notice Micaiah, when they ask him what he says. At first, Micaiah says, "Yeah, go ahead. God will give them into your hand." He says the same things the false prophets say. God's judgment comes in three phases on a backslidden people.
And Jacob goes on to talk about the fact that the first one is God stops correcting people. And we know from Hebrews that God disciplines those and corrects those who have fallen away. And he goes on, and I mean, even today, if we look at some examples, this just came out this week. Here's Jesse Duplantis and Kenneth Copeland talking about the fact that God gave them a plane, their own jet, so they don't have to fly commercial with all those drug-addicted people that fly on commercial planes. And they can, it's like a prayer room in the sky for them. God has given them the blessing. They conned a bunch of people to buy an expensive toy. And the prophets who won't say things, Jeremiah chapter 23 says, "Woe to the shepherds who are destroying my sheep. They're destroying and scattering the sheep of my pasture, declares the Lord. Therefore, thus says the Lord God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who are tending my flock, you have scattered my flock and driven them away and have not attended to them. Behold, I'm about to attend to you for the evil of your deeds, declares the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, do not listen to the words of the prophets who are prophesying to you. They are leading you into futility. They speak a vision of their own imagination, not from the mouth of the Lord. They keep saying to those who despise me, the Lord has said you will have peace. Nothing bad's going to happen to you. Everything's going to be fine. No testing, no tribulation. You'll have your best life now. Send me some money and you'll have prosperity. The Lord has said you will have peace, and as everyone who walks in the stubbornness of his own heart, they say, calamity will not come upon you. The anger of the Lord will not turn back until he has performed and carried out the purposes of his heart. In the last days, you will clearly understand it. I did not send these prophets, but they ran. I did not speak to them, but they prophesied. But if they had stood in my counsel, then they would have announced my words to my people and would have turned back from their evil way and from the evil of their deeds." This is what the church, I believe, needs to hear today. And I thank God for Jacob, who 15 years ago stood and gave a message like this. You need to go listen to the whole thing. Here's his conclusion of the message, and we'll close with this.
What a tragedy it is when God has blessed and raised people up and given them something to do, and all they've built crumbles. They never reach the goal. They never make their appointed destiny. They never get to where God has for them to go and do what he has for them to do. They lose it. You ride in Ahab's chariot, you become identified with Ahab. You're in bed with him, he's in bed with Jezebel. You're in bed with the Pope's in bed with the Dalai Lama. That's what it comes to. That's the way it was. That's the way it is. And that's the way it's going to be. The appeal of my heart, my prayer, is the Jehoshaphats of our day, the godly men, men I know are good men, will get out of that chariot before they get shot. Get off that idiot box. Get off that platform. Don't give him a place in your church. Don't distribute that literature. Don't sell those books in your bookshop. Do not love those who hate the Lord your God. Jehoshaphat was a good man. A good man who made bad mistakes. And right before our eyes, there are good men today making that same mistake. May God in his mercy correct them and protect us. God bless you and thank you.
Lord, help us to hear, help me to hear, this church and the larger church to hear the word of the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.